It happens again. Silencing the voices of democracy. Now Republicans are saying that a transgender lawmaker can no longer represent her district. As a matter of fact, let's go to this. Here it is.
Then to Montana. Amidst a wave of anti-LGBTQ legislation from Republicans, the state's first and only transgender lawmaker is now being silenced after she said this about their push to ban gender-affirming care for children in that state. Take a listen.
If you disallow the use of the medical care that is accepted by every major medical association, if you disallow that care and don't allow people to have access to that, the only therapy left is either A, meaningless, or B, conversion therapy, which is torture. If you vote yes on this bill and yes on these amendments, I hope the next time there's an invocation, when you bow your heads in prayer, you see the blood on your hands.
That was Representative Zooey Zephyr, who the Republican speaker now refuses to recognize if she tries to speak on any issue. And we should mention that ban of medical care is just one of the many pieces of anti-LGBTQ plus legislation Republicans want on the books.
Damn shame. Let's put the picture up full mass. You see, she's a lawmaker. She became a lawmaker because people voted her in. People voted her in because the Constitution mandates we have a representative form of government. This is a constitutional dynamic. You can disagree with policy. As a matter of fact, that's what the chamber is for. It is for debate, argumentation, disagreement, compromise, and then execution. It is not a prerequisite to agree in order to be heard. Montana's first openly transgender lawmaker has sued the state over the Republican-dominated legislature's decision to ban her from the House floor. Zooey Zephyr, who has been barred from even physically entering the House chamber, has sued over what lawmakers and lawyers describe as an unconstitutional censure, and it is retaliatory, silencing. Zephyr's 34. Zephyr, who took office after being elected in November 2022, sparked controversy when she criticized those of her colleagues who supported a since-passed bill that prohibits gender-affirming care for transgender youth. If you vote yes on this bill and yes on these amendments, I hope the next time there's an invocation, when you bow your heads in prayer, you see the blood on your hands, she said during a debate on the bill April 18th. Let me explain to you what she means by this, because many reporters have not either A, explained it, or B, they have explained it outside of its proper context. What she's referring to is science. Science. The reason why medical associations consider it good practice for this type of care for youth is because literally it actually decreases not only depression in youth, but also suicide. Yes. You see, when you are adversarial to the notion of who a person is, we have seen that in young people in particular, it leads them to a different path. And sometimes that path is self-destructive when not affirmed. That is the science. You don't have to like it. That is the data. Okay? So she's making an argument about life to people who call themselves pro-life. They don't like how she said it. They really don't like who said it. You see, if you're okay with this, don't get upset when they dismiss two young black lawmakers for saying something different, because it wasn't what they said that got them expelled. It was who they were that got them expelled. So let's be clear. Let's have linear logic and integrity about this. If we say nothing when they knock on the neighbor's door, believe me, they're going to knock on yours. There's more. Let's put up the Freedom Caucus. Look at them. The Montana Freedom Caucus, which the lawsuit describes as a group of ultra-conservative representatives, they issued a statement demanding Zephyr be censored, noting that the group has deliberately misgendered Zephyr in all external communications. This is to disrespect her, obviously. Now, look at this crew here, okay? Number one is 90% old white men, okay? You have one woman here, and I'm going to get into that in a moment. Let's put up the speaker. He's a piece of work, all right? His character reflects his appearance. The next day, the House Speaker, Matt Regier, a Republican, posed a question and said, I think she should apologize. But she did not. So once again, I want you to see the similarity. Keep his picture up. When Tennessee suspended two young black male lawmakers, it was to do what? To put them in their place. How dare you speak to us that way? Who do you think you are? A white man like us? Keep in mind, once again, this is not about the objection nor the policy. This is about who it is saying it. Okay? So this guy said if she did not apologize, her comments will be considered a break in decorum and that he would no longer recognize her to speak until he believes she could maintain decorum going forward. How ironic is that? He says, apologize or I would disenfranchise every single person that voted for you. Apologize or I would disenfranchise every single child that's in your district. Apologize to me or I will disenfranchise every taxpayer in your district. But if you apologize to me, I restore all of it. There's more. In accordance with his word, Rajir refused to recognize this elected official the next day on April 20th, when she asked to speak on a different bill, a bill that had nothing to do with the previous bill that would officially define sex as based only on one's reproductive system, essentially denying the legal recognition of transgender and intersex people. 4 days later, April 24th, the House voted to block Zephyr from even talking. That same day, when protesters inside the chamber chanted, let her speak, let her speak. These are citizens talking. She stood up. She raised a microphone, which did not even have sound. Around six of those protesters were arrested. Let's put up the Republican Majority Leader, Sue Vinton. On April 26th, the House, led by this Republican, proposed that the lawmaker be censured over the protest. 1-2 combination. Now, come back to me for a second, because I need everyone to understand what has happened. She does not apologize to the white male who's on a power trip. He says, I'm going to no longer recognize you. And then you have a different order of business, a different bill. And while proclaiming her policy directive for this bill, protesters come in. She lifts up a microphone, doesn't have sound. All of a sudden, there's a new motion from the House led by the Republican Majority Leader, Sue Vinton. All right. So Sue Vinton says, oh, my goodness, I can't believe she held up that microphone. Whoa, that is such a break in decorum. And she said, we need to censor her again. The vote passed 68-32. The next day, according to the lawsuit, her key card to the Capitol building was deactivated. And she was told that she was not allowed to work on a public bench outside of the House. Think about that. You can't even sit outside on public property. You are an elected official. The lawsuit says that Zephyr was censored for silently raising a silent microphone above her head. That is it. And failing to calm the protesters, while other legislators have faced no consequences for significantly more confrontational behavior. For example, you see, during the coronavirus pandemic, individuals brandish guns during their protest, the lawsuit states, despite them brandishing guns during their protest, no legislator was disciplined in those situations for the behavior of those with whom they were politically aligned. They brought guns, and absolutely no censure happened. The lawsuit filed by the ACLU on behalf of Zephyr and four constituents says that the measure not only deprives her right to freely engage with the legislative process, as she is elected to do, it also denies representation of the constituents, which is true. Since the motion was passed, Representative Zephyr has been effectively removed from the legislative process entirely, and the voices of her 11,000 constituents have been collectively silenced. The lawsuit alleges that the retaliation is based not only on her actions, but her, who she is. First open transgender woman elected to Montana legislature and a member of a community that has been targeted by the current state of state lawmakers in office. Listen, I want to appeal to those who may lean right. Okay? I want to appeal to you. This is the shredding of democracy. You may not agree with Ms. Zephyr, but we should all agree that the constituents who elected her deserve a voice and a seat at the table. Because we all know if you are not at the table, you are on the menu. This action has put 11,000 souls on the menu that have no representation now. Nobody to say, hey, wait a minute, let's think about this. It would affect my community in this way. This is not simply about policy anymore. This is about down, low, horrible, corrupt dictatorship and control. And what are you going to do? You know it. To those who may not subscribe to the left-leaning ideology that I do, fine. State your case. I don't want your voice to be silent. I want you to be able to make your point. If people elected you, talk. You have an opportunity, you have a seat at the table. This, Sharon, what are your thoughts?
These are some mentally and emotionally very small people. Yeah. She can't sit on the bench outside. Were they waiting to urinate on that as well before they let her sit there? Exactly. They need to say what it is, Dr. Richey. Either I'm over here and I'm hate-filled and insecure, or over here, it's a fake war to steal your vote. It's one or the other. It's one or the other. It's disgusting.
We will follow this to conclusion. Naturally, the lawsuit is going to create some friction that will continue for a minute, but it may make a difference in how we decide these things moving forward. Legislators cannot do this to people just because they don't like them or who they are.